won't win.
Okay.
I'm disappointed.
Deborah,
yeah, they're signed in.
Give us a signal. We're not very big. Drum roll.
Ready? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to draw for prizes, so go ahead and draw. Mm-hmm. Or we can get somebody out there to draw, too.
Yeah, you can get somebody out there.
Number 13, Rosalyn.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
I need to mark her name so I don't have to guess later.
Thank you. Oh, my goodness.
Okay, and... Oh, yeah, get somebody out there to draw so they'll know it's not fixed. I can't read it. Liz?
The what? The what? Tweet.
Yeah. Oh, yay! Good. Good. And one more.
Number six.
Nancy Reeb. So we'll redraw. We do.
No, we don't.
Oh, no. Okay, we have to redraw. We have no 24.
Yeah.
Number 20, Adam.
Oh. Yay!
That's right. Yes, our honored guest, Adam, won. Okay.
Handed it over to his mom. Okay. So after the door prizes, I promised Adam the night is his.
All right. Well, first of all, I wanted to thank Welka and Janelle for asking me to do this. I'm excited to be here. It's a good opportunity for me to relive the experience. It was honestly one of the best times of my life. I had such a good time. So I'm really excited to talk about it. And we can go to the next slide here and get started. Okay, so first of all, where I studied is Luxembourg, and if you haven't heard of it, because a lot of people haven't, it's that tiny country right there in between France and Germany. You can see the little red spot on the map there on your left, and on the right is an up-close look of it. So the little red spot on Luxembourg, that's Luxembourg City. That's where most of the people in the country live, and then mostly in the southern half of it is where everybody lives. The northern half is the Ardennes Forest. So that's pretty war-torn from the World Wars, but it's also very beautiful. You can go up there and hike. It's one of the top hiking countries in the world. But I lived in Differdange, which you can see is marked on the map down there on the left. So it's about a 40-minute train ride from Luxembourg City to Differdange. So that gives you an idea of how big the country really is. It's very, very small, but they have their own language, Luxembourgish. It's kind of a mix of French and German, but you can't say that there because they'll get offended. It's their own language. It's their own language. But they all speak French and German and Luxembourgish, usually, the older people anyway. The newer generation, not as much. But then a lot of them also speak English. So that was very helpful for us because it's really a crazy experience. The first couple of days you're walking around and no one is speaking English. Whereas obviously here, everybody speaks English. So that was a lot, but people were very helpful. And I did learn a little bit of French, a little bit more German, and almost no Luxembourgish, but that's okay. That's okay. So we can go to the next slide. So this is the school. It's Chateau Mudec. The earliest records are that it was a castle that was originally made in the 1100s, but there is a possibility that's even older than that. So it was super cool that I went to school in basically a castle, a medieval castle. All of my classes were there, and yeah, it was very cool. Only the right portion of the castle is original. The second portion was added about 200 years ago. And then in like the 1960s or so, there was a graduate from Miami University who served as the U.S. ambassador to Luxembourg, and then later the head U.S. foreign ambassador. And he was a big proponent of making Miami have their permanent campus somewhere in Europe, and he wanted to be in Luxembourg because he was half Luxembourgish, half American. So he worked with a country who had good relations with the U.S., because it was the United States soldiers in World War II that came through and liberated them. So that was the joke that my host dad always said. He would call us his liberators. Obviously, he was very sarcastic a lot, but he was a good guy. And so there was good relations there. And so yeah, that's where I went to school. And it's a pretty big deal there, and it's a big deal here in the US, actually. It's the only study abroad program that worked throughout the entire pandemic. So when the pandemic happened, immediately the kids were sent home, so that semester they were sent home, but by the fall they're up and running and they had a group of 40 kids. Their usual running is about 100 kids, and it was about 110 when I was there in the spring, and that was about 20 guys and 90 girls. So I'm having flashbacks right now, but no, but it was still a lot of fun. I made a lot of friends. And it's a big deal over there. We got four speakers to come in. One of the speakers was the Prime Minister of Luxembourg. So we were honored to see him. He is the only head of state ever in the world to be married as a homosexual while in office. So that was a pretty cool thing. And yeah, he was a really great guy. It was awesome to meet him. We also met the new U.S. ambassador to Luxembourg, who was the former mayor of Milwaukee, I think. So that was kind of interesting. But for me, my major is political science and philosophy, so I really enjoyed meeting those people. And I guess I am going to talk about my classes a little bit here. On this bag here, I brought some goodies to pass around. But the bag we all got, and it says study, engage, travel. And our dean really emphasized the study part, but that wasn't the big part for the rest of us, if I'm being honest. But my classes were actually really cool. My first class I went to every Monday from 8 a.m. to 11:45 a.m., so that was a long class. But it was taught by the head secretary of Benelux. And Benelux is a joint supranational organization between Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands. Those three countries actually founded the EU and play a big role in founding the UN as well. So they were kind of the first countries after World War II to kind of come together and be like, we should work together more to work for peace so that we don't have a lot of war. So yeah, he was a big deal and he taught my class. So that was really cool for me especially. I had another political science class that was a seminar. It's called a capstone, so it was like my senior class. And I took that. So there's only four of us in there. I really like that. We just got to talk about stuff. And then we take, every person in the program was required to take Basically, it's a class where at one point during the semester, you go on a trip with the class, which was really cool because those are people I don't normally go on a trip with. And yeah, it was just a lot of fun to do that, so I'll get to that. I'm going to go over where I traveled, because the thing about Luxembourg is it was a lot of fun there in Luxembourg, but it wasn't very big, and there wasn't a lot to do. So pretty much every weekend we went to a different country, because it's right in the middle of Europe, and it's really cheap to travel there. My dad's shaking his head, but yeah, it was a lot of fun. So I went to a total of 14 different countries during this semester. Yeah, it was super fun. But I lost my train of thought. 14 countries, yes. It was in Luxembourg. My classes, right. So my class, my class for the travel, it was The Rise and Fall of Adolf Hitler. And we were originally supposed to go to Poland. We ended up not going to Poland for reasons that I'll get to later, which you can probably imagine. There were some things going on in the world. But so instead, I went to Bavaria, and I'll get to that later, but that was a lot of fun. So that was one of my other classes. I took another class, Russian folklore, just because there was a Russian professor there. How it works is they have a couple professors from Luxembourg that are there permanently, and then the Miami staff actually rotates like every year, so that the staff in Miami gets a chance to go and, you know, study abroad too, I guess, which was cool. So I took his class. He usually takes a group to Russia. He definitely did not do that this semester, but so that was cool. And yeah, those were my classes. So I'm gonna pass around this goodie bag. You guys can pass around and look at it. I didn't buy a lot of stuff while I was abroad, even though my mom told me to, because the shopping thing I kind of left to the girls on the trip. But I did buy a lot of food. That was the thing that I was focused on, was trying all the food. I like food, so spent a lot of my money on that. But I do have some things that I brought back, so you guys can take a look through that as I pass it around. And I will start with where I went every weekend. Oh, that's right. So this was our host family. So you had the option of staying in a student apartment or being with a host family. And I am really glad that I did the host family. When we got to the airport, it was like a really long day, because you like go back in time or however that works when you travel across. So it was a long day, and we got there, and the lady who was there was like, well, you three won the host dad lottery, was what she told us when we got there. So I was really excited, and she was right. He was really awesome. His name was Guy. You can see him there. We had a family dinner once a week, and he always made more than enough food. And I forgot the preliminary disclaimer. When I was first asked to do this, I showed a draft to my grandparents of this. And my mama, like halfway through before she finished it, she goes, well, you can't show this to the Welka because it's going to make you look like an alcoholic. That was. So I just want to talk a little bit about the culture of alcohol over there. It's a little bit different. The thing is, over there, there's no drinking fountains like anywhere in any of the countries I went to. Water is not free. You have to pay for it. And same with restrooms, actually. You have to pay for restrooms everywhere you go, which was really annoying at first. We were like, why do we have to do this? It's annoying. A couple times we were like, we're just not doing it, and we just didn't. But anyway, but the thing is, every restaurant you go to, their draft beer is always cheaper than the water. It's a gimmick, I think. I don't know what it is, but so if you see me in a picture drinking a beer or alcohol, first of all, I am 21. Not that it matters over there, because it doesn't, but I am 21. It's all right, mommy, okay. I just had a beer with my meal is mostly what it was. It's kind of a thing you do over there. As you can see, Guy's holding a giant bottle of champagne in this picture. He always gave us plenty of alcohol, but we were very responsible with it. And that's the thing over there. Most Europeans are a lot more responsible drinking alcohol than I would say my generation is drinking alcohol over here in America. And that's with my experience with Europeans of my generation over there. They're just a little bit more responsible with it. So we tried to do the same. But yeah, there's lots of pictures of me with alcohol in this. But anyway, this is Guy. He gave us family dinners once a week. He always gave us plenty of food, plenty to drink. It was always a good time. And then those are my two roommates. David is the one, let's see, on the far left. He and I known for a while, and then Jack, the other one, I met on the trip. They're both awesome, and we all live with Guy. We're all wearing soccer jerseys. He was a big soccer fan. That's the big thing over there. That was his team, so it was funny. He got us those jerseys as a gift, but we had already bought him that jersey as a gift beforehand for the end of the semester. So we like gifted each other at the same time. It was this cute little thing. It was nice, but we took that picture. Anyway, yeah, that's my host family, Guy. Yeah, he had a really nice house. He gave us each our own bedroom. We shared a bathroom, and he was very lenient with us. He did a lot of travel, too, while we were there, so sometimes he wasn't even there. But yeah, so that's Guy, and we can go on to the next slide, please. Thank you. Yep, this is all of us at our host dinner. So how it worked every weekend was you obviously picked who you travel with. It was free travel. So these are the five people that I traveled with a lot of the time. It was a mix of them. Sometimes it was just us six. There were times they went on a group with up to like 14 people. Sometimes it was, I just did solo travel a lot too. But this was the main people I traveled with, and yeah, we had a really good time. So, yeah, and yeah, the European hospitality is very similar to the Southern hospitality. I don't know who got it from who, but you guys do a great job of it. They're just very kind, and Europeans are not as outgoing as Americans, I would say, but once you get them going, they really don't stop. So I guess in that sense, they are similar to us. But anyway, yeah, we can go on to the next slide here. So this is Luxembourg City, the capital. It has, I can't remember how many people live in it, but different than the city I lived in was the third biggest city, and it had less people living in it than here, actually. It only had 20,000 people living in it, and that was the third biggest city in the country. So you can imagine all the Luxembourgish people, they don't call, this is the only city is Luxembourg City. Every other place is just a town or a village. They don't call it a city because this was the big place. So it's basically up on a fortress, the city is. And it used to be surrounded in water like a moat, but since then the water has receded since 100 years ago. So they built it up in the underground part called the Grund. And that was a spot we liked to go to. It had all the cool restaurants. There was a really cool German restaurant. We went there all the time. But the city was very cool. It was very old. It's kind of like a under the radar but very popular destination in Europe. Not a lot of people go there, but I would recommend it. I thought it was a very cool city to spend a couple days in. So yeah. So the first weekend we went to Bruges, Belgium. There on the left, we're walking actually by the North Sea where we stayed, which is pretty close to Bruges. And I actually wrote a paper on Bruges, so I can talk a lot more about it than some of the other places for one of my political science classes. But there on the right, we're eating Belgian waffles, and they live up to the name. They're very good. Same with Belgian fries, also very good. I'm going to talk a lot about the foods, so just be ready for that, because that was a big thing for me. But yeah, that's right. But yeah, the waffles were very good. The North Sea was pretty cool. I think there's another slide for Bruges. You can go to the next one. Yeah, so this was Bruges. It's one of the only cities in Europe that still has a medieval facade. And that's because during World War I and especially World War II, obviously there was lots of bombings, but Bruges was a very populous trade city in the medieval times. But by the time World War II came around, the water had receded, obviously, because where we stayed on the North Sea was about 40 minutes north of Bruges. During medieval times, the water came right up to Bruges. So it wasn't a port city anymore. It was very poor by the time World War II came around. And it was so poor that neither the Allies nor the Axis considered it important enough to bomb. So it still has its medieval facade. And actually, the city has regulations for the downtown center, where if you look at the outside of the buildings, they're kind of tilted a little bit. And if you look closely, there's little like black almost hooks sticking out of every single building. And that's because the outside is literally a facade that's hooked on to the building. You could push that off and there would be an actual outside of the building. And then you go inside and it could be a disco club. It wouldn't look anything like what you could expect it to look like. But the outside has to look like a medieval facade. So for that to be the first city that we saw in Europe just blew our minds. We were like, if it's anything like this city, it's going to be an amazing semester. So I went with a group of like 10 people. We stayed in an Airbnb. There's a bunch more from our program that went there, so we met up with them. And Bruges is actually one of the most popular tourist destinations for Europeans from other countries. They like to go to Bruges. We met with one of our host speakers that met with us was the Belgian ambassador to Luxembourg. And he told us that Bruges was too touristy, and he suggested other cities like Ghent or Brussels. I didn't go to Brussels. That's the capital. That was too city-y for me, but I ended up going to a bunch of cities anyway. But Bruges was super cool. It was very medieval, and we took a tour of the city, and we saw a lot about it, and it was an awesome first trip. I liked Bruges a lot. Here's some more pictures of Bruges. That one in the middle is the clock tower. That's one of the oldest buildings in the city. The one on the left is the steeple for the church. And the one on the right is a chocolate beer that I tried. We went into this medieval cellar that we were recommended. So it was a cellar as old as medieval times. And we just went up there and asked him what he recommended. And he said we should try that. And it was pretty good. It was pretty good. I liked it. Chocolate beer. Yeah, it was okay. Okay, so me and my roommate David both did not have classes on Wednesday. So we did lots of, well, we say we're gonna do lots of day trips on Wednesday. This was the only one we ended up doing the second week. But it was cool. It was Trier, Germany. That building that you see right there, it's two sides of it, is called the Porta Nigra. It is the northernmost Roman fortress that was ever built in Rome. So this was that was ever built in Europe. This was as far as the Romans got, was all the way into Germany. It's the far west tip of Germany. It's right by Luxembourg. It was only an hour train ride from where I was, which is cool. There's trains everywhere in Europe. It's all public transportation. I took a lot of planes too, but the planes were cheap then. I don't think they're cheap now, but they were very cheap then. I took like a $5 plane ride one time even, which was crazy. But yeah, so that's Porta Nigra in Trier, Germany. It was super cool. We toured, we went on the inside of it. It was a very old building. But I think there's more to Trier if we wanna go on to the next slide here. So this is me and David's first German beer. It was a big thing for us. For me, it was getting in touch with my German heritage. And David's minor is actually German. So he wanted to go to Germany a lot. And he did get a lot better with his German, actually. It was already pretty good, a lot better than my Spanish, which is my minor. I didn't have a lot of chance to practice that. But yeah, the beer in Germany was by far the best out of any of the countries I went in Europe, spoiler for the rest of it. But yeah, it was very good. Yeah, it's Germany. It was great. And like I said, I went on a study tour to Bavaria for a week, and Bavaria is like when you think of Germany, that's the Germany that you're thinking of, basically. It's very different from the rest of it. The rest of Germany doesn't even say it's a part of Germany, actually, but I'll get to that later. The picture on the right is an old, not a Colosseum, but it was, there was lions there, there were gladiators there, an old gladiator pit. So as you can see, the Romans actually made an impact. This was their like northernmost spot. This was their gates. You could actually walk around the gates of the city. They were, part of it was still there. But this was really cool. Me and David went on the under part of it and saw like all the mechanisms that you did for like lifting up all the lions and the gladiators. And there was the water down there. And we were the only people there too, because it was a Wednesday at like 11 a.m. so no one else was there. So we just kind of just like had it to ourselves, walked around it. But yeah, it was super cool. So again, after this trip, we were like, yeah, this is really fun. We're having a good time. And we're still here for another like semester. So this is awesome. But yeah, we can go on to the next spot. So that weekend, I went to Metz, France. The next slides, when we get there, are going to have pictures of the cathedral. I tried to include a lot of pictures of the cathedrals I went to. Obviously this is a church event, but we went to a lot of cathedrals because they're really cool. They're everywhere in Europe, and they're beautiful on the outside and the inside. So I have lots of pictures of those you guys are going to see, but this cathedral is definitely one of the coolest I saw. It was kind of the touristy part of the city. It's the second most touristy spot in France behind Paris. And it was also very close to where we were staying, so we went there. The picture on the left is hot wine, which is something I didn't even know about, but the girls wanted to try it, so I said, well, I'll try it too. That seems fine. And it was good. We actually had it at the Joan of Arc bar. It was at the former house where Joan of Arc actually died. So she went to Metz, France, towards the end of her life and died there. And there's just places like that everywhere in Europe where you're like, this is just a regular building. And they're like, no, something crazy happened here hundreds of years ago. We're like, oh, well, that's cool. But yeah, so that was cool. And then the cathedral was very cool. I've got some pictures of the inside of the cathedral on the next slide. Yeah. I forgot one of my other disclaimers, is that any like really good pictures you see, I definitely didn't take. What we did was every weekend we made a group photo album, which is basically every picture that any of us takes, it goes onto the cloud and we all have access to it. And the joke was that the girls, when they saw something they want to take a picture of, they were like, you know, like getting the perfect angle of it. And then the guys, we would just walk by and go like this, and then we just keep walking. That was all that we did. So if it's a good picture, it's not mine. If it's not a good picture, probably mine. Anyway, yeah, so that one on the right there is the pulpit and the altar. It was beautiful, but just to get to the, you really can't really see the size of the cathedrals in any of the pictures. That kind of goes for lots of the stuff you see. It obviously looks a lot better in real life, but I tried to put the best pictures in, and yeah, this place was huge. They're always, the ceilings are very tall every time. The stained glass is very beautiful in a lot of them. But yeah, this cathedral was crazy. Oh, and Jack, my roommate, is also a pastor's kid. So we did a lot of this sort of stuff everywhere we went. It was just kind of a cool thing that we did. A lot of the times when the girls were shopping, we'd be like, well, we're just gonna walk around and wander in cathedral. And that was what we did. But yeah, that was pretty cool. The next weekend, we went to Milan, Italy. Shopping center of Europe. So this was the girl's idea, but we threw him a bone. And we actually ended up liking it a lot. It was super cool. It was crazy because this one had a better cathedral the very next week, I thought. The outside of it you see there, we took a picture of in front of. It was crazy. We ended up taking a tour and going up to the top of it and walking around. And it's just the detail that goes into a lot of the sculpting on these cathedrals on the outside and the inside. You can tell that it took hundreds, sometimes thousands of years for some of these. This cathedral, they started working on it in the 1300s, and they're still working on it. They're not done with it. The original plans, they're not done with. They're still working on, which is crazy to think about. But yeah, the outside was cooler than the inside on this one. I thought the inside was still huge, but touring it, going up to the bell tower was really fun, and I enjoyed. This is right in the town center, so it was very cool to see. This is also in Milan. So this was the Navigli district, which was the shopping area that we went to. There on the left, you can see it was all canals, so kind of what you would imagine Venice to look like if Venice looked nicer. But yeah, it was very pretty. At sunset, we took a lot of pictures. So that picture there in the middle is what they did. They did this thing called aperitivo in Italy, specifically in the Milan area, but they do it everywhere in Italy. And what it is you go and you, it's like a happy hour type thing. You go and you pay for a drink, and then you just get unlimited appetizers. And then if you want to order another drink, they just give you more appetizers, like the same thing over and over again. So we thought that was pretty cool. The food was obviously amazing in Italy. I went back to Italy after this trip, which you'll see, because I wanted to go to Italy. That was a big spot for me, so I went to a couple other places. But yeah, the aperitivo was super cool. The food was very good, and I tried a lot more of the food. And that's a picture of the six of us that went on this group. This was kind of like my main group of people you can see there that I went with for a lot of the trip. So another day, well, we were in Milan, we went to Lake Como, which is near Milan. We took a train for about an hour to get there. And Lake Como was the most beautiful place we had seen up to that point, so it gets better. But it was beautiful. We took a funicular, I think they're called, up, and it just takes you up the mountain, and then you get the views like that. And then we also walked down on the water. But a lot of movies were filmed here. There's a scene from Casino Royale here. Star Wars Attack of the Clones is seen from here. George Clooney has a lake house here. We didn't go see that, but there's tons of lake houses. The area that we went to is like where the town is, but like the lake goes on and there's lots of private property over there that costs who knows how much money, but we didn't go see it. But yeah, Lake Como was a very beautiful area. We couldn't believe it, but there's more to Lake Como on the next slide. So that was a beer cannon that we had one time. I didn't even know what that was. But I thought that was an important... We shared that with like 12 people, so it really was only like one or two per person. But there on the right, that's Dave and his girlfriend who was in the main group we traveled with. I actually introduced them, so it's kind of a big deal. But anyway, they survived study abroad, which is a big test, I thought. But that's us having dinner up on Lake Como, like up on the mountain where you can look down, which is crazy because like literally behind David, or if you look to your left, like the views were just right there, and we were just having dinner there. And I had a really good like fish pasta, And we just had a, yeah, it was a really good meal. And it was crazy because we're just like, I mean, is this just what people do all the time in Europe? Which it's not, of course. We just did the touristy stuff. But like, it also is kind of an everyday thing. Like their meals that they have in Europe, everywhere in Europe, it's like an event. It's like 3 hours. Like when we would go to restaurants, we would like have to keep asking for the bill, where it's like, if you go to a restaurant here, they want to push you out and get more customers in. But here it's like, they'll keep you. They want you to keep buying stuff, but they will keep you in your restaurant for as long as they can. But yeah, so we really enjoyed just kind of hanging out, just relaxing up there. It was a beautiful area. So our next trip was Porto, Portugal. This is the trip that we went with I think it ended up being like 16 people. We all stayed in one Airbnb. So some, like when there were smaller groups, we stayed in like hostels. When I traveled solo, I would stay in like mixed dorm hostels because they were very cheap. It's not the safest, so like the girls never really wanted to do that, which I completely understood. And even a lot of us didn't want to do it, but when I was traveling alone, I usually tried to be pretty safe, so I did that. But a lot of the time was Airbnbs, which were really nice to travel to, because it was just like you're living in someone's house. They kept it up really nice. Like this one we went to, when we got there at the kitchen table, they had port wine waiting for us, which is, if you ever tried it, it's a very thick, syrupy wine. I wasn't really a fan of it, but it was very different. And you'll see later, that picture right there, actually, we took a bus tour of the wine country, which even though it was in the middle of spring, winter, so you couldn't really see the grape bushes growing, it was still just an absolutely beautiful area, and you could just drive these winding roads through it. We visited two different wineries on that day. It was a full day thing, but it was super fun. But yeah, the people there, Porto was kind of like eye-opening because it was more of a bigger city that we went to. And we spent a lot of days traveling. Some of the group actually went surfing on Porto. They have some of the biggest waves in the world off of Portugal, and Porto's got some big ones. So it's right on the coast. So the city is on the coast. We stayed in the city apart. Some people went surfing, but Portugal was very cool, and there's some more pictures coming up. Yeah, so there on the left is the city at sunset. There's the sunset spot. You take another funicular up, and you just go watch it. There was hundreds of people up there, and that happens every night. The city was just so lively because I didn't go surfing, so me and a couple other guys, I wish I had, but I didn't end up going. So me and some people just walked around the city, and it was just so lively. It was just, I don't know, it was, the city was very old, and the roads were like winding up and down. There's not a lot of driving in European cities. In Porto especially, there was mostly just walking, which we did a lot of walking. I did a lot of walking the whole trip, actually. It was a lot of walking, but it was cool. And there on the right is a good picture of one of the wineries we went to, which, yeah, I just kind of appreciated the scenery we got to see on the winery trip. It was very beautiful. But yeah, that was Porto, Portugal. We flew to Portugal, and that was about a three-day weekend trip. All of these are about 3 to 4 days. Sometimes it was like Thursday to Sunday, sometimes like Friday to Monday. But it was pretty crazy, honestly, because like you would get back and then you'd be like, okay, where are we going next weekend? You'd have to sit down for like a lunch with people and like plan where you were going. And it's pretty stressful sometimes, but it was also like, this is really fun that we get to do this every single weekend. But it hurts your wallet. It did. I worked before, and I'm working. I got back with little to no money, so I'm working again now over at the day school. It's a lot of fun over there. But it was, Porto was cool. So the next weekend, we went to Budapest, Hungary. A group of 8 of us stayed at an Airbnb. That was a good picture. I'm not in it, but I thought it was a good picture of the background, so I included it. And those are the girls that we traveled with, me, David, and Jack. Budapest, Hungary was the weirdest place I've ever been in my life because this was the only place in Eastern Europe we went. And actually, when we came back, our school issued an advisory alert and said, they said they strongly recommended you don't go to Hungary again. And some other countries like Moldova and those sort of places that we were prohibited from going because this was when Putin invaded the Ukraine, which was pretty shocking for us because it was like, you know, like we're in Europe right now. And we seemed like, oh, we're distant from this. And even when we were in Budapest, like we knew this was going on and it felt different. But at the same time, there were already refugees pouring in from the Ukraine to Hungary, going to Budapest. This is the main population center of the country. The rest of Hungary is mostly farmland. So it was crazy to think about, especially for me as a political science major, like all my classes, we stopped talking about our material. We started talking about that because these are like world events that are happening while we're studying abroad in Europe, which is cool, but it was also very sad, obviously, for what was going on. But yeah, Hungary, Eastern Europe is very different from Western Europe. There is a clear divide. It was very cool. All the people were very friendly. The language that is spoken there is like nothing I've ever heard before. Like at least when you hear other foreign languages, you'd be like, okay, like I understand what's going on here. But this was just like I had no idea really when I was listening to it. But the city was very cool. It's actually split by a river. The left side is Buda. The right side is Pest. We stayed on the Pest side, but all the stuff to see is on the Buda side. So we crossed the river like every day. The picture on the right there is at the Fisherman's Bastion, which is like an overlook of the city. It's got some of the older stuff there, but that's a falconer, which I thought was super cool that he just stays up there. And we paid him to do some stuff with his falcon that was pretty cool, like made him fly around. We weren't like afraid to hold him, but we didn't really want to hold him because the falcon is a lot bigger than it looks in that picture. But yeah, he's in traditional falconer garb, which is a big traditional thing there. But yeah, Hungary, Budapest was very good. The food there was one of my favorites. I had goulash. I had lots of other stuff, big words that are weird. But the food was very good there. I had a lot of it. It was cheap, too. The currency there, not all countries in the EU use the euros, where if you saw the bag, I had some euro coins in there. Some countries joined the EU but kept their own currency. So they use Hungarian francs. And it's not that the currency is inflated, but it's just on a different meter. So basically, like, 1,600 Hungarian francs was, like, $2. So I'm having dinner, and I'm paying, like, 20,000. I'm like, I don't know if I can afford this. And they're like, no, really, it's okay. It's only, like, $15. But the currency was different there, too. Everything was very different. But there is more pictures, I'm pretty sure. Yep. So that on the left is their, like, Congress building, sort of. This is lit up at night, obviously. We went on a night cruise that was a lot of fun. And that's what it looks like at night with it's lit up. We went to it during the daytime, too. It also looked very cool then. There on the right is a Turkish bath, Hungarian bath. They call them Hungarian baths, but they're like the same thing as Turkish baths. It was definitely an experience we wanted to do, but I wouldn't do it again. It was pretty gross, I have to be honest. Imagine, like, if you don't like public pools, it was like 10 times worse. The water was warm, but like not a good warm. It's not like a hot tub. It's hot because there's like 100 people in it. And the indoor ones were even worse, but it was very cool. It was old. Like this bath had been here for hundreds of years. But yeah, it was a cool thing to visit. And I would recommend doing it because it's definitely something to do. Everyone there does it, but I'm just not gonna do it again. All right, we got it. Yeah. Okay, the next weekend we went to Malta. This is our last weekend trip before we did a week-long study tour, which I'll talk about for the one class. And after that, we got spring break, so we had a week off. So we had to plan what we were going to do for spring break, and I'll get to that when I get there. But we basically had 2 weeks off of class, which was really cool, and this was our last weekend before that. And yeah, we went to Malta. Malta was probably the oldest place I went to in terms of like what they had to look at. There on the left, I went to the catacombs in Malta, and those bones are some thousands of years old. We went to a city you'll see in the next slide, that the most of the buildings are still intact, and this is like BC era type stuff that you're seeing, because Malta is an island south of Sicily, and Sicily is like the bottom part of Italy if you look on it like the boot, that like the part that sticks out. It was very small. We basically walked around the whole island, but it's its own independent nation. They speak Maltese. It's a weird language, again, like Hungarian. I didn't understand it, but they also spoke English, which everywhere you went, people pretty much spoke English. It's, you know, the English or the language of business, as people say. So, you know, it was kind of weird because you almost felt dumb everywhere you went, because everywhere you went, these people spoke multiple languages, not just their native language, because they have to learn them because they interact with people from other countries. Because in the EU, there's an area called the Schengen Zone. Most of the countries are in the Schengen Zone, and it's free travel in between it. So it's not like you're not stopping at a border. You just drive right through, and that's what it is. And this is something that happened recently. There was passed in EU legislation. I know a lot about it because my class that was taught by the ambassador or the general secretary was about the EU. So it was pretty cool to kind of see how the way people interacted, because they all knew all these languages, and they would just default to whatever language they wanted to speak with. And they had no problem switching to English to talk with us. And that happened a lot, actually. To David, he would try and speak German, and then they would just switch to English, and I felt bad for him. But he tried, and they appreciated that he tried. But I also think it was a chance for them to practice English, too, because it's not a first language for them, and you can tell that. Like, it's not like it's fluent, but it's not, you know, like the way we talk. But it's obviously a lot better than if I tried to speak any of their languages. But yeah, Malta was very cool. When we went, it actually rained a lot of the weekend, which wasn't great. But the one day it was nice. We went to the beach. The water was freezing because it was like March, but that's okay. We went in anyway. We hiked because there's just mountains right next to the beach, which is crazy. It's kind of like not a volcanic island, but it's very mountainous, I guess you would say. There's lots to do there. We took a boat ride to a small island off of Malta called Gozo, and it's very small. We actually went by another island where only a pastor lives, and he actually had like goats on the island, and like we walked around the whole island in like 10 minutes. But there's lots of these little islands around there. We went a boat ride. That was super cool. But on Gozo, I got that calamari there on the right, which was really good. I really like calamari. My grandpa always buys it for me when we go to like Rainforest Cafe or someplace. So I tried real calamari there, and it was delicious. I couldn't eat all of it because that just seemed like a bad idea, but it was really good. And these are the next pictures. Yeah, there on the left, my pants are rolled up because the water like came up on where we were hiking and just got me all wet. And then I'm wearing a woman's jacket because I didn't bring a jacket, and one of the girls had an extra jacket, and it was really cold because I was like, oh, I'm going to Malta. I'm not going to pack like warm clothes. I'm not going to bring a coat. And then it rained and was like freezing the whole weekend. But that's okay. I still had a lot of fun at Malta. There you can see on the right, that was some of the views. We really spent most of the time walking around the island those couple days. It was a very cool area. David actually scuba dived, so he scuba dived there. And he said that was amazing, the stuff that he saw down there. So yeah, Malta was a vacation spot for sure for lots of Europeans, but I liked going to Malta. Yeah, there on the left was a pretty cool view that we saw while we were hiking after we swam. And then there on the right is that old capital I was talking about that was the capital for hundreds of years. The last couple hundred years it hasn't been, but like going back into BC times, it was the capital. And yeah, Malta has been conquered by pretty much like all the Northern African countries at some point were in charge of it, and then all the European countries at some point were in charge of it. So there's just a lot of blending of cultures there, but it's a really old place and it was really fun to visit. So because we did not go to Poland, because by the time our study tour was going to happen, about a week before, Poland already had 7 million refugees from the Ukraine, because they share a huge border with the Ukraine. So it was just, the university decided that it was a good idea if we just didn't go there. Some of the other study tours, one went to Berlin. There were a couple others that went other places in Europe. But ours got moved to Munich, which we were okay with. I wanted to go to Munich. I was planning on going there anyway. So we spent a week in Bavaria and Munich. There, that food I had there on the left, the sausage, the kraut, the German potato salad, I had that pretty much every day, and I was so happy with that because it was delicious. I tried to get in touch with my German roots, but I realized that German-American roots and German roots are pretty different because I couldn't find like a bratwurst anywhere. There's plenty of sausage, but it wasn't what I was expecting, but the kraut was very good, and that was super cool. So this study tour was organized. We had, actually, the director of MUDEC came on ours, plus our teacher. Every study tour had two teachers go along with them. And we did like half like class stuff and half, you know, just like leisure stuff. So there in the middle is actually where the Nuremberg trials were held, if you know where they held for a lot of the Nazi officials. The room looks smaller than what you see in like on videos from when you look at it, and that's because the room was expanded sort of, and they did like their Hollywood stuff to make it look bigger. But yeah, that was we were just like, wow, this is where it happened. And we walked to the museum and learned all about America's presence in Germany after World War II with the Nuremberg trials. And it was very cool because it had a lot more to do with our class, the rise and fall of Adolf Hitler, than just going to Poland. I was disappointed we didn't go to Poland because we were going to go to Auschwitz and another concentration camp, and Auschwitz was the biggest one, and it was something that I wanted to see. Obviously, a very somber experience, but we still did go to one of the concentration camps outside of Munich. I didn't take any pictures there. You're not gonna see any pictures there. Some people took pictures there. There's nothing wrong with taking pictures there. It just I didn't feel comfortable taking pictures there. But it was a harrowing experience, to say the least. We walked through the gas chamber. And that was just, yeah, that was a lot. One of the girls on my trip, actually, her grandparents were in the Holocaust and actually were killed at the concentration camp that we were at. So it was really a heavy day. But yeah, we did go see that as well. But like I said, I appreciated the tour because all the stuff we did was very informative for learning about what we were learning about in the class, which had to do with Hitler and the Nazi regime, the Third Reich, and all that sort of stuff. So as a history buff, it was interesting. Obviously, it's a sad topic to talk about. So we balanced it out with fun stuff we did the week too, which I enjoyed Bavaria, the area, a lot. So that was cool. There on the right, you'll see the Nazi Party grounds. That's where Hitler would give his speeches when he would have the Nazis come. And they've kept the party grounds there. We actually got a private tour of the inside where, I can't remember the name of his head architect, but we learned about him too. He did all of his buildings there, but they've kept the party grounds there and lots of the stuff there. They're not sure what to do with them. Germany, since World War II, has gone through phases of not talking about what happened, to we should talk about it, to the newer generation saying, oh, that's not our history, why do we have to learn about it? But every German student is required to visit at least one concentration camp throughout their career. Most of them go and see more than that while they're schooling. And I thought that was a very good idea. And we talked to lots of Germans on our trip, lots of our tour guides. Some took different approaches to talking about what happened. But you know, all in all, I think the countries obviously came a long way since then. But again, it was interesting to see these sort of things, because I am a history buff. But there was a lot more to this, because this was a week-long trip. So yeah, this was Nuremberg, the first couple days. Then we went to Munich, which is the capital of Bavaria, one of the states in Germany. There on the left, we're at the original Hofbräuhaus, where Hitler actually used to give his speeches when he was still coming up in the ranks as a party leader, when they would just gather in beer houses. I had been to the Hofbräuhaus in Columbus, Ohio, and other Hofbräuhauses, they're around. So it was really cool to go to this original one. We actually went back to it 4 times, not just this week. We ended up going back to Munich, which I'll talk about later, but the Hofbräuhaus was very cool. The food was awesome. The beer was the best I'd had. That thing in the center is the town center building. And every morning at 11 o'clock, they have these little like Muppet things that do a little dance, so people gather and watch that. That was pretty cool. There on the right was a church tower that we climbed up, and it had a great view of where I took the picture of the town center there. We spent 3 days in Munich. We visited a lot. Munich was very cool. There on the left is FC Bayern's stadium. We got a private tour of that. They're one of the best soccer teams in Europe. They're always in the Champions League. They always win the German League, the Bundesliga. They're the best team by far. They just buy out all the other players in the league. My host family is a fan of the rival team for them. Dortmund. So it was funny that we went in to visit this. We sent him pictures and he was like, you guys are traitors. How could you go in there? But we got a private tour. We went to the locker room. We got to go on the field. You can't actually walk on the turf. That's like a sacred thing for soccer players. Like only soccer players walk on the turf. But we got to sit where the coaches and the players sit. So that was very cool. And I wasn't a big soccer fan before I went this trip. But now I'm like, I should get into this because a lot of people like it. And my brother plays it too. So it's pretty cool. It's a fun sport. But yes, you would. So this was probably maybe the most beautiful area I went in Europe. It's like top two probably. It was King Lake in the Alps. I ended up going back to the Alps in Austria later because I thought the Alps were just beautiful. And it made me want to see more of the nature that is in our country, because I haven't been out west and a lot of that stuff is out there. I haven't seen, there's not a lot over here, but the Alps were like mountains. Like when you think of mountains, it's like these are mountains. You know, they're not hills, they were mountains. And there was this lake that we went on. We took a boat to a little island in the middle of the lake. On the boat, the captain stops the boat. He pulls out like a trumpet and he plays like a song and it echoes across the water and the mountains. And we were like, this is the most amazing moment ever. Kim, this is happening. But it was absolutely beautiful. We walked around this island. We got the most amazing views. There on the right, you can see a good view of all the mountains from like up high. We went to a very high point in Germany to see as much of the Alps as you can see. The study tour is really cool because the director just schedules it for everything and we just do like all the coolest stuff in the area. And you get to see not just the cities, you get to see like the parts that you wouldn't go visit if you were just a tourist traveling, because our director is from Luxembourg, he's from the area, he knows all the spots to go. So yeah, the King Lake was beautiful. And here's more pictures. There's the King Lake on the left, and there's more pictures of the Alps on the right. So I actually ended up doing solo travel for the full week after the study tour because I didn't want to go on any of the trips that my friends were going on. Some people, their families came for spring break, they went with their families. My family couldn't come, but that's okay. That's all right. So I ended up solo traveling, which was something, something that I had wanted to do. And it actually ended up, I actually called both my mom and dad at the end of the week, and I was like, this was like the best week of my life. I ended up loving solo travel because I got to do exactly what I wanted to do. And it was, I met so many people. It was super cool. So the first couple of days, I planned it out myself. The first couple of days, I went to Barcelona. That on the left is a fish paella, and it was really good. I could not eat all of it. Again, just too much fish, but I'm a big seafood fan, and it was delicious. There in the middle is a view of the city. You can see in the far back, the ocean's right there. And then you have the city right there. And there on the left is the La Sagrada Familia. It's the main cathedral of the city. It just stands out when you look at a view of the city. You can see it's way taller than everything else. There's one architect that basically designed all of Barcelona. You have to look up his name because I forget it and don't know how to pronounce it very well. But the cathedral on the outside was the most amazing cathedral I had seen on the outside. It was astounding. This guy's design, it reminded me just what you would imagine Spanish architecture to look like, I guess, if you're familiar with that sort of art. It was beautiful to see. I walked around it like a bunch of times and looked at all the stuff. I didn't get to go on the inside, but some of my friends did, and they sent me pictures, and the inside was looked just like the outside, basically, and it was gorgeous. But yeah, Barcelona was a very fun city. There's more coming up, too. So yeah, the same architect designed this whole park that it looks natural, but it's man-made. And there I met up with some of my friends from MUDEC that were in Barcelona. I knew they were there, so I was like, okay, well, I'll just come and hang out with you guys for some of this trip. And it's called Parc Güell, and it was the most beautiful park I'd ever seen in my life. It was huge. You could walk through it for about 3 hours all around it and see all this stuff. There were live musicians everywhere playing. That's the other thing in Europe, too. Pretty much every city you went to, there's live musicians. It's the same way in America, a lot of ways, but it was super cool to see these live musicians. And the music that they played was usually American, which is funny, but it's not necessarily that our American culture gets over there, but definitely the pop culture is very popular over there. Like, that's their pop culture they adopt, or our pop culture they adopt pretty much as soon as we adopt it. And it's a big thing for them. So I heard a lot of American music. Obviously heard some Spanish music as well, but the Parc Güell was a beautiful area. I loved walking around it. That's at the top of Parc Güell. There's these three crosses. So I walked up there, and there's a live musician up there. That was super cool. There on the right is the beach at night. So Barcelona is a big party city in Europe. The thing, I'm sure you've heard of the siesta, they take a nap in the middle of the afternoon, which basically means that the restaurants don't open until 8. And if you're going to go to get a drink afterwards somewhere at a bar, that's not going to open until like 10 or 11. And then if you're going to go clubbing, which is the big thing to do there, you can't even go clubbing until 1 a.m., which is just insane to me because I go to sleep way earlier than that usually. But I was like, I'm in Barcelona. This is what people do. So I did stay up one night and I went to the club, and all the clubs are on the beach. So you just go into the club, you know, you dance, whatever, and then you can just walk out onto the beach. And then you can just walk right back into the club afterwards, which was just, that blew my mind. I thought that was so cool. But Barcelona was awesome. I wish I had gone to more of Spain because Barcelona is supposedly like different than the rest of Spain. But I plan on going back to Spain at some point. But Barcelona was very cool. And then that was the first couple of days of my spring break of solo travel. Then I went to Rome, which was a place I had to go to. For sure. I'm a big history buff, like I said, so I wanted to see all that stuff. The Colosseum there on the left. Right there in the middle is the Roman Forum. In the back, you can see the Colosseum. So it's all of this ancient Roman architecture that they have just kept up. And they restore it, too. They're constantly restoring it. Rome was awesome. There was so much to see there. Basically, what happened was I got to my hostel. I went out to dinner because I got there right around dinner time. And they sat me next to a guy. And we started talking. And he was like, well, I'm actually staying in the same hostel you are. And he was like, I'm like, wow, really? What are you doing in Rome? He's like, well, I'm actually here for the same amount of days you're here in Rome, and I've never been here. So I was like, all right, well, tomorrow, let's just do everything. So we got up at like 6 a.m., and I went around with this one guy. He was from Saudi Arabia. He was like a world traveler. He's a doctor, actually. He's coming to Miami, Florida to teach at a medical school, actually. But yeah, so I met him, and we just walked around Rome and did everything. We went to the Vatican City, which you'll see pictures of that later, but that was awesome. Rome was really cool, and that pasta on the right was delicious. So good. So good. In Rome, I just ate good every single meal, and they do a good job of that there. They make sure that you are comfortable and having a great time, so... that there on the left is the Parthenon, which it's literally just in the middle of the city, and we walked up to it, walked through it, and walked out in like 5 minutes, which is like, I was thinking I was going to have to wait in line for these things, but no, we just walked right in and walked out. But that was amazing, because that was something I read about in school books, and I was like, wow, this is crazy, and then it's just right there. But everything is just right there in Rome. It's a huge city, and they just kept all of this stuff and just built around it for thousands of years, which I thought was super cool. There on the right is the Sistine Chapel. You are not supposed to take pictures in there. I didn't hear him say that till after I took the picture, or at least that's the story I'm going with. But that's the Sistine Chapel. It was beautiful. It's in the middle of the Vatican Museum, which is a huge museum. I mean, you could spend hours walking around in there. It's like the Louvre, which I also went to, and I also did not spend enough time in. But there's a lot to see. We like kind of beeline it for the Sistine Chapel, which is funny because in every room they're like, Sistine Chapel this way. And it still takes an hour to get there because you have to walk through everything. But the Sistine Chapel was amazing, everything you would expect it to be. It was beautiful. There on the left is the inside of St. Peter's Basilica, which was my favorite cathedral that I saw inside and out. The inside of it is huge. The Mass on Sundays, it's free. People just go in there. I guess the lines start at like 6 a.m. and go way back. Everybody wants to go every Sunday. I didn't have the chance to go in for a Mass, but I did go in and tour the place because it's free entry if you wait in the line. And it was kind of funny, as I went in line, there was this huge class of like probably like 100 kids like going to get in line, and I just like ran right in front of them right as they got there. And the teacher was like, nice job, and I was like, thank you. But yeah, and that's St. Peter's Square on the right. I really don't have any words for the inside of that cathedral. That it was, you know, it's supposed to be like, okay, yeah, this is the cathedral, and it was all of that and more. It was huge. I walked around for probably about 2 hours. It was crazy to see St. Peter's crypt right there and think like, that's Peter, the rock of the church. Like, there he is right there. I'm kind of still in awe of that moment, honestly. They have a little prayer room where they're like, if you believe, you can go in and pray. So I went and did that, and there's people doing that too, but... Yeah, St. Peter's Basilica, probably my favorite building that I went into. I'm glad I did that. And of course, Vatican City is its own nation, so that counts as one of my 14 countries. So that was good too. But yeah, there's a look at the wider area inside of St. Peter's Basilica. You can see St. Peter's crypt there in the back still. There's an up close at one of those little pictures they have. Of course, they have these everywhere in the church and everywhere in Europe. Icons are a big thing with Greek Orthodox, but the Catholics, especially in Europe, do not shy away from that sort of thing. I know that's not a big thing for us, but it was still very cool to look at all of these things everywhere I went. And yeah, that's St. Peter's Basilica in Vatican City. So then, this was probably my favorite place that I went to. I'm a huge Godfather fan, if you guys have heard of that movie. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. I know, he did. James Caan just died. I was sad about that, but... Yeah, I had to go and see where they filmed a lot of these scenes in The Godfather, because when I saw that movie, I was like, this is beautiful. I want to go to these places. No one else wanted to go to these places. I guess I'm just an old head, because that's an older movie. But I was like, I have to see this. So I went there by myself. This place, I didn't meet anybody. I mean, I met some people, but I didn't really hang out with any of them. It was just me walking around and doing what I wanted to do. There on the left, I had swordfish rolls, which was, it wasn't a lot of food, but it was probably my favorite meal I had. It was absolutely delicious. Everything was a little bit more expensive there than other places I went, but it was super cool. That place in the middle there, that's Taormina, is a city I went to. You can see the whole city pretty much right there, right by the ocean. All of Sicily is like that. It's like old Italy, basically. There in the back left corner, if you look closely, you can see an old Greek theater that I toured. That Greek theater is like as old as Malta, like I was saying. The Greeks were there long before the Romans were there, obviously. There on the right, it was... To get up, to get that picture in the middle, I had to take a Passage of the Christ walk, I think is what it was called. And they had those little statues everywhere. And I asked the guy at the bottom, I was like, so how old are these things? And he was like, we don't know. I was like, okay, yeah, this is pretty cool. But yeah, I walked up that and got that picture, and that was a cool moment because I was just by myself kind of doing my thing. When I got up there, there were three guys that, the thing about it when you're an American in Europe is everyone knows it. And it's not just because when you talk, like I would just not talk, and they would still know I was an American. And nobody wears shorts over there, so then I started wearing pants everywhere, and they still knew I was American. So one day I just asked Guy, I was like, Guy, why does everyone know I'm American? And he goes, we just do. He would not tell me why, but it was true. Everywhere you went, they would stare at you because it was like you're out of place here, which was weird at first. We kind of got used to it, but yeah, so I got up to the top of this place and there were three guys talking. I immediately knew they were American, so I started talking to them because you kind of started doing it too. You're like, well, I know that person's American. I don't know how, but I know it. But yeah, it was kind of weird because you would see Americans a lot of places you went over there, but it was like an event for Europeans to see you. They're like, wow, look at that. But yeah. Yeah, this was Taormina, but there's more pictures here in Sicily. Oh yeah, this was the $5 plane trip I got from Rome to Sicily, Taormina, which was about an hour and a half plane ride. Obviously, it's within the same country, so that's probably why it was cheaper, but my flight to Barcelona was only $30, and my flight from Barcelona to Rome was $20. So I did all of that travel, and then back up to Luxembourg for less than $100, and that was just the plane ride. So that was pretty good for how much money I was spending every weekend, which is just ridiculous to think about now, but I had saved up for that. I was ready for it, but there on the left is the Bar Vitelli, which is in The Godfather. So that I was just, my tour guide, it was funny. I had to pay for the tour, and it was $100 per person, and they only did it for two people minimum. So on the TripAdvisor, I said, well, I have an infant, because the infants are free. And then he gets there with the car seat. He's like, I was like, you know, my girlfriend said it'd be better if you stayed. And then like 5 minutes later, I was like, I gotta be honest with you. I don't have a girlfriend, and I don't have a child, but I just wanted to do this tour very bad. And he was like, that was really smart. No one has done that before. I was like, thank you. But so it was just me and the tour guide on this tour, and he said the whole time I was just smiling the whole time, he said. I was so happy. It was just awesome. It was the end of my week traveling alone, and I saw all these really cool places from The Godfather, and the tour guide knew a lot about it, not just The Godfather stuff, but like the history of the place. And this is cool because where I was staying was sort of by the beach, but then he came picking me up in his car, and all of these villages are like up in the mountains, which are right by the beach. Like there's these little villages in the mountains that have been there for thousands of years, and that's where they filmed these places, but like the tourist places down on the beach, and you have to go with a local to get up there. Like you wouldn't know to get up to these rural places, but there on the right is the cannoli, because leave the gun, take the cannoli from the movie. But the cannoli was absolutely delicious. That was so good. Like I said, all the food in Italy was the best by far. There on the left is a view of the city of Forza di Agra, where they filmed the wedding scene when they're in Sicily. They're walking down, if you know the movie. And there on the right is the church where young Vito escapes from the people that had just killed his family. In the second one. So yeah, it was just a crazy moment for me because I'm a huge fan, like I said. So that was awesome that I got to see these places. So then I got back from spring break, which was like, wow, that was a lot. And then we went on another weekend trip the next weekend to Amsterdam. Actually, earlier in the year, I had tried to go to Amsterdam, and this was the one instance where I had troubled public transportation because there was a huge storm across all of Europe, and it hit Amsterdam hard because it's a big port city right on the ocean. So they closed the city down, basically. They just wouldn't let us in, our connecting train. So we got stuck in another city in the Netherlands, which was cool. Everyone in the Netherlands is very nice. They speak perfect English, better than mine, way better than mine. And we asked them, we're like, where'd you learn that? And they're like, here. So they just learned English and Dutch perfectly, I guess. But they're all very nice, all very tall. But it was a different place to go for sure. Had a weird vibe to it, but I liked it a lot. Amsterdam especially was a super cool city. A little bit more modern than other cities I had been to, which was a change. I like the older cities better. But there on the left I had pancakes. Amsterdam pancakes are the big thing in Netherlands, Dutch pancakes. But they're super thin, almost like crepes, and they just put everything on it. So I was like, well, I'll just try it like that. So that one had like walnuts and fruits and spinach and arugula and stuff on it, but it was delicious. That picture in the center is a reconstruction of a medieval, or actually I think that's Renaissance era, Dutch ship. I went to the Marine Museum. That was really cool because I kind of like, that was again like a history buff and marine stuff, that was cool. And then there on the right is a picture of the canals. You've heard about the canals in Amsterdam, they're everywhere. And everyone rides their bikes. When I tell you that there were, I mean, millions of bikes in this city. And I didn't see all of the city, but where if I counted them, it would have been over a million. There were bikes everywhere. The bike lanes are more important than the driving lanes. No one really drives cars. Amsterdam, they've perfected public transportation even more than anywhere else in Europe. And so public transportation is big and everyone rides their bikes, but it was a super cool city to go at. It was. I liked Amsterdam. The girls went to the tulips. That's the big thing in Amsterdam. I can't remember what it's called right now, but there's just fields and fields, miles and miles of tulips here. And so they said that was very beautiful. Looking at the pictures, I agreed. They were very beautiful. Kind of wish I went to that. I just couldn't wrap it in my head to spend $50 to go see them, but you know, none of the guys went, but the girls loved it. So good for them. I'd included them because I think they are beautiful. There's some more, yeah. Some up close. Yeah. Yeah, they do a good job there. There's the Dutch windmill. Of course, you have to include that. There you kind of see some of the bikes. And you see sort of the Netherlands architecture is kind of similar to what you saw in Bruges. Netherlands and Belgium, again, very close to each other economically, geographically, however you want to say it. So there's some interplay there. But yeah, Amsterdam was a beautiful city. I kind of just walked around it, really, and just looked at everything because it was just like, wow, this is very cool. Next weekend was Easter. It was very expensive to go anywhere. We ended up going to Austria. That was good for me because I wanted to go back to that area. It's not far from where I was on the study tour to Bavaria, but that was okay because the mountains were beautiful. There you see a cross. Me and the guys hiked up to a cross that was on top of one of the mountains, so that was super cool. And actually, if you look on some of these pictures on the mountains, you'll see there's just three crosses like planted. People just go up there and plant these. Some of these are very, very old. So we thought, we got to go up and see one of those. So we did. We hiked up to one. We didn't hike all the way, full disclosure. We took a funicular and hiked maybe a couple hundred feet. But still, we saw the cross. But yeah, again, beautiful sights up there. It was absolutely gorgeous to see the Alps again. I loved seeing that. That was amazing. We went back to Hofbräuhaus. To get to Austria, we went to Salzburg and we went to Innsbruck in Austria. But to get there, we had to go to Munich again. So like, oh, we have to go to Munich again. Maybe we'll go to Hofbräuhaus again. We had to go to Munich on the way there and on the way back. So we went to Hofbräuhaus both times, of course. And again, great time at Hofbräuhaus. There on the right is a picture of Innsbruck, probably the most beautiful village in the world because it's just a tiny little village surrounded by mountains. And there's tons of these places in that Bavaria, Austria area where it's just mountains and then villages inside the mountains and then just more mountains. And they're just all separated by trains that go through the mountains, which was super cool. But yeah, that was a great picture. Obviously, I didn't take it, but I thought that was absolutely beautiful. And yeah, there's a picture of those of us that went on that trip. Again, it was a smaller group. And there on the right, we're actually at Augustiner, which it was crazy. We went there to get dinner, and it wasn't really a dinner place, we found out. We went there, and the outside and the inside were just packed with people in the German clothes. I'm forgetting the word right now, but Lederhosen, yes. And they were kids, people our age, I should say, just everywhere in Lederhosen. Like, it was just like you were going out to a bar like in America, but it was just everyone was in Lederhosen, and they're all holding around these mugs and full of beer, obviously, but it was cool. You went in, and they just gave you a mug. And then they're like, go over there, and there's just these giant barrels of beer that this beer master is by, and he just opens up the tap, and it pours out, and then you just go. And then the only food they had there was pretzels. So we had a couple pretzels for dinner that night. And they were really good pretzels, of course. It wasn't enough food, so we ended up going to an Indian restaurant after that and ate a bunch of Indian food. The Indian food and the Arabic food there is very good because it's a lot closer. I think, I'm assuming, it's just better in Europe because it's closer to Europe or they interact more. But there's lots of restaurants there. The most popular fast food in Europe is kebab, which it's not like a shish kebab. It's like, you know, those kebabs of like gyros, like the lamb meat that they have on the thing, and it turns around, they shave it off. So we got that a lot. If you looked in my bag, there was actually the little punch card for the snack Antalya. That was the kebab place at Diffredange where we were staying. We went there every single weekend probably because it was cheap food, and Guy didn't want us eating in his house unless it was with him for his meal. So we're like, how are we supposed to do this? But I forgot to mention that at the chateau, every day we got lunch for free. The chef there was awesome because he made different meals every day. but they were always great meals, and I always went up for seconds. And by about the second week, he stopped asking me, do you want like a double portion? He just gave me the double portion. So me and him kind of had an understood thing that I always came up for seconds. He always gave me a lot. But yeah, the free lunch was great. We had a dinner on our own. But yeah, the Indian food, the kebab was great. We went there a lot. So the next weekend, I also did go to Mass on Easter. I forgot to say that. In Innsbruck, it was supposed to be in English. It was in German. It was an Easter vigil. It was okay. I didn't speak any German, but I knew what was going on. I'd been to a couple of church services in my time, I'm sure you can imagine, yeah. So I knew what was going on. But yeah, it was very cool. I just wanted to go to church in one of those cathedrals that I had seen so many times. I was like, I need to be in church for one of these. So that was very cool. But next weekend I went to London. Again, it was solo travel because I liked it so much. I wanted to do it again. Nobody else had wanted to go to London. They were either already gone or they were going somewhere else. So there on the left is the Shakespeare Globe Theater. It's a reconstruction, obviously. They put it right there next to the river. So that was cool. I saw that. The London Bridge right there on the right. London was cool because, again, I just kind of walked around, saw what I wanted to see because it was solo travel, did what I wanted to do. And there's more coming up here. This is the Tower of London. So lots of prisoners were held there. It was a super cool place to see. I actually went into the jail cells and you could see these people from like over 1,000 years ago that had carved their names in or like messages that had been accused of like witchcraft or whatever they were in jail for. Lots of like, even like poets and stuff had been kept in there. There's these huge ravens they keep there. The Tower of London was really cool for me to just walk around, go my own pace, because I'm a history buff, but like some people in our group were like, I don't want to see this stuff. I want to go shopping. It's like, fine, go shopping. I'm going to stay here. But yeah, and then there's obviously Big Ben. That was super cool. Just walked by that. I didn't end up touring that. But right behind Big Ben is Westminster Abbey, which is on the next slide. So there's Westminster Abbey on the left. There on the right is a picture of me with Myles Garrett. If you don't know who Myles Garrett is, he is the starting defensive end for the Cleveland Browns. He was drafted like number one overall a couple years ago. He's like our best player. And I'm just walking around the Abbey and I'm like, I recognize that person from somewhere. And then I'm like, he doesn't look as big as Myles Garrett, but I think it's Myles Garrett. So I'd only seen him from the back, so I walk around and it's like kind of like, who is that guy? And I'm like, yep, that's Myles Garrett. So I realized in that moment, I'm like, wow, I'm probably the only person in London, maybe in the UK, that knows who that guy is, because like they don't watch American football, but I know that that's a football superstar. So I walked up to him and I was like, are you Myles Garrett? And I was like, wow, that was a dumb thing to ask him. Obviously he knows he's Myles Garrett. He was like, yes, I am. And I was like, can I get a picture with you? I'm like a huge Cleveland Browns fan. He's like, yeah, for sure. He was so cool about it. He was actually there with his girlfriend. And they're getting a private tour of the place, so I didn't want to interrupt him. So I just took a picture, and I was like, thank you so much. He was like, yeah. But besides meeting him, which was like, I posted that, and all my friends were like, wow, that's crazy. Like, what are the odds you run into this dude when he's in London? But he actually, I know about him, a little bit about him personally, because he like posts stuff on social media. And he's like a history buff, like nerd sort of guy too. So he was totally into this stuff, just like I was. So I was like, no wonder he's here. But Westminster Abbey, besides seeing him, was really cool. Pretty much anyone you know who's British is probably buried there if they're dead. Everyone is buried there, pretty much. So you just, and it's funny because you just walk, like they're just these signs just as big as these squares and it just says their name on it. I'm like, wait, that's like a famous person. I'm just like walking over his like thing and they're everywhere over the whole church. The church was beautiful. I thought it was super cool. There's all sorts of stuff in there. Oh, I forgot, in the Tower of London, I saw the crown jewel and all those sorts of things. So that was very cool too. I walked by the palace too, Buckingham Palace, but Westminster Abbey was very cool, and I saw him, and I had lost my mind when that happened, so. Yeah. So there's a wax museum there that's like a big deal. They're all around the world. The main one is there. Madame somethings or another's, I think. Yes, that's it. You guys know it. Anyway, I didn't pay to go into it. I wanted to, but it's kind of expensive. And I was like, I have other stuff I want to do. But I went and I like kind of snuck in sort of to like the entry area and took a picture with the Beatles. I'm a big Beatles fan. So I thought that would be cool. And then also in London, there are just parks everywhere. That's pretty much, if it's either cities with buildings or parks. And that's all it is. And their parks are everywhere. They're huge. So I walked through Regent's Park and another park that sounded famous when I walked through it, and I was like, this is probably important, so I'm gonna enjoy it. But it was beautiful, all their parks are gorgeous. There's actually British gardens everywhere, or English gardens, they're called, everywhere in Europe. There's probably even some here that I just didn't know about, but I went to some in Italy, I went to some, so I was like, when I got to London, I should go to these ones now. But yeah, that was London. I think there might be a couple more pictures, I'm not sure, I don't remember. No, there's not. Okay. There's actually only two trips left. I know you guys are probably about done with this. You probably thought it was shorter, but that's okay. I'm almost done. I have a couple videos at the end that kind of give you a picture, a more of a picture of what was going on just besides these pictures. So that's kind of cool. But this was technically my last trip, but I put it before this one because the last trip has a video for itself. So this was Paris. I went to Paris to go to a soccer game. Paris Saint-Germain, PSG, plays in Paris. They have the best soccer player in the world. Messi is on their team. And then probably like two other top five players are also on their team. Kylian Mbappe and Neymar. So I had to go see them play. And it wasn't that expensive. And I got Jeremiah a soccer jersey or a soccer scarf, I should say. That's the thing they have from there. So he liked that gift. He's a big soccer player. If you're wondering what I got Elijah, it was a chalice like from Bavaria because that's what he asked for. And I was like, okay, I'll give you a chalice. So I got him that. Let's see. I got my mom a bracelet from the Vatican City. Oh, there it is. Yeah. And then, Dad, what did I get you? No, I don't forget. I got you the golf ball from Germany. Yeah, so yeah, in every place. Yeah, that's right. So yeah, my dad golfed in high school. I golfed in high school too. We're both not very good, but we have fun. But yeah, so everywhere in Europe, obviously there's lots of markets in the cities. You see that here too. But they're big on their markets. Everywhere you go, there's markets selling pretty much anything you could find. In Germany, I was like, I'll just look for something here. And I found a golf ball that said Germany on it. I was like, that's really cool. So I'll get that. But Paris was, I didn't think I was going to like Paris that much. I was like, I need to go there because it's Paris. I'm not too into it, though. I actually really liked it. I was there for about a day and a half. I saw pretty much everything. The Eiffel Tower there on the left, it's not as tall. It's not as tall as I thought it would be, but the base is so wide. I mean, it's really big. Notre Dame is something I really wanted to see. I saw the Notre Dame. That was cool. You can't go in it because it burned down a lot of it. So you actually can't even get that close to it a couple years ago. It burned down. But yeah, Notre Dame was cool. Eiffel Tower, also very cool. Went into the Louvre, saw Mona Lisa. It's pretty, I mean, it's underwhelming. It's like, there's Mona Lisa on this wall and there's this huge line going to see. And then behind it, there's this huge tapestry, like probably as big as this wall, I would say. And yeah, and just like, this is way more amazing than that. But the Mona Lisa was cool. I went up and saw it. I like the Mona Lisa. I've included one picture I took a picture of. It's a picture from the French Revolution. It's pretty famous. There on the right are the Napoleon apartment. It was the most extravagant thing I'd ever seen. I mean, back then it must have cost who knows how much money, but I understand why they revolted because it was just filled with so much rich stuff. But it was pretty cool. It's actually not even Napoleon Bonaparte. It's like his son or grandson or something, Napoleon III, I think. But that was in the Louvre. The Louvre is also huge. It was very cool. Very cool. Those were our seats for the soccer game. We were in the front row right by the goal. Messi had a ball past him. He was right by the right post, and he almost hit it in, and that would have been amazing. But we did see Neymar have a penalty kick, which is when they just like kick it right at the goalie and score a goal right in front of us. So that was super cool. We enjoyed the game a lot. And then on the right there is a crepe because you have to try that. So I tried that and it was good. It was good. So then Greece, this is the one that I have a video for. What Greece was at the beginning of our semester, Guy came to us and he said, so every semester I take my kids on a trip. And he takes them to Greece usually. So we went to Greece. We all wanted to go to Greece. We agreed to do that. We stayed on a boat the whole time. We slept on the boat. They cooked us food on the boat. We just sailed around Greece for about 5 days. And it was my favorite trip. I had so much fun. What's that? 5 days on that boat. I was the only one that didn't get seasick also. Everyone else got very sick and they blamed it on the food. And the food was amazing. So I don't know what they were talking about. But I didn't get sick. I had a good time. They did get sick, a lot of them, but they still had a good time. That boat we all slept on. There were those six of us plus Guy plus one of his old guests. Guy, he was a gardener for the chateau, volunteer work. He didn't work for them. He made the chateau look beautiful. It does look beautiful. You can look at pictures of it. There was the one at the beginning. But yeah, he does all of that. That's why it looks beautiful. And he has hosted over 200 guests in his house. He's been hosting since the 90s. Usually he has three or four. Yeah, he's the ultimate. He lives by himself. He's about 55-ish, I think. He's been doing it for a while, and yeah, he just loves doing it. And he was awesome. He honestly made our trip in Luxembourg that much better because it was just, it was awesome to go back there every week during the week, and we just hung out with him at night because he was such a cool guy. And he really did a lot for us. And so when he asked us to go on the trip, we were like, yes, for sure. And it was an amazing trip. So there's the six of us that went on the trip. He let us bring three of our friends. So we did that. And then I've got a video, of course, of us on the boat. It's a really great video. One of the girls was like, well, let's take video content. And we're like, okay, what are you going to use that for? And then she made the video at the end. We're like, this is awesome. And so since he does this every year with all of his groups, he shows the video now to his groups to be like, this is what we'll do if you want to come do it. So like, we're like the advertisement now. But yeah, there's a couple more pictures before the video. This is us in the boat. And then there's when we gave him our jersey. And then we gave him his, he gave us ours. The captain was very cool. His name was Captain Greg. He spoke almost no English. But his first mate did, so that helped us out. She was very nice. But they were both super cool. They took us to the coolest places in Greece. We went to Thessaloniki, was the nearest city. And then we went to Halkidiki, which Greece, if you look at it, it's actually on my hat. I don't know how well you can see the hat. There's like three claws on the right. Those are bigger. On the left, there's three tiny claws you can see. We just sailed around those three tiny claws to all the cool parts for those 5 days. And then on the last day, we did a lot of swimming, obviously. They cooked us. They would catch fish on the boat and then cook it, and then we would eat it. And they were just amazing meals. I couldn't believe it. I told you guys I love seafood, so I was just in heaven. I mean, it was great. I loved the food on the boat. They were great. But yeah, you'll see some more in the video.
Feel like Superman, they gon' remember me. I think I know I can. Who says it's hard to reach? Who's gonna stop me on the road to success? I don't know. They try to break me down, but I'm still on my feet. Full of life, so why is it hard to breathe? Oh, why did God create this world so unfair? I don't know. Sometimes I feel like I can't run, I can't crawl. And sometimes I feel like I ain't nothing at all. Life is a journey.
Wait, I'm sorry, can you pause real quick?
But I'm okay when I lie.
I forgot another disclaimer. Like I said, Europeans, they're a little private. Once you get to know them, they're very funny. They don't really stop. Guy especially was very funny. And at the end of this video, he does flip the bird. So I just wanted to disclaim that. If there's any children watching home live streaming, you might not want to see that. He was very funny. He meant it all in jest. He wasn't being rude or anything. It was very funny. We did it. I forgot to say that, and I thought it was important that I warn everybody for that.
Feel like Superman, they gon' remember me. I think I know I can. Who says it's hard to reach? Who's gonna stop me on the road to success? I don't know.
don't look down. 'Cause I'm on top of the world.
Yeah, I wanted to be safe there, but yeah, as you can see, that was a great time. I love that trip a lot, and so that was our last trip. Well, technically Paris was the last trip. That was like a couple days before we left, but I included Greece at the end because that was like the trip. So they had like a send-off, like a dinner we did with all of us. We did class superlatives, and I won class clown. So yeah, I know. It was a big thing for me because in high school I came in second for class clown to one of my good friends. So I kind of like campaigned. I was like, I want to win class clown. But I earned it, I think. Anyway, yeah, so on the right there we're at the German restaurant in the Grund in Lux City, like I told you, our favorite restaurant to go to. It was kind of funny because you just take trains. They come like every like half an hour. Our house was right by one train station. The school is right by the next train station. So that was convenient. And then a couple more stops later was the city. So we went to the city just whenever we wanted to. And that was a lot of fun. So we did that, of course. We spent the last couple of days in Luxembourg just spending time with each other and with Guy. So a couple more pictures here. There's on the left, that's the bar that we went to. I took a picture with Maddie there. So like the locals didn't really like us all that much. I mean, they liked us, you know, they liked, you know, what we brought to the city, but they didn't want us at their bars. So we had our own bar that we went to basically where all the MUDEX students go. So we went there on the last night. There on the right, you see all of us hanging out there on the last day. And, okay. And okay, that's everyone in the program. So that's all of us there. I can't even see where I'm at, so I can't point myself out to you, but I'm in there. I think I'm like in the middle, sort of. There on the flagpole, there's the Luxembourg flag and Miami's flag on top. And, all right, I think there's a couple more slides on here. Yeah, so there on the left, on the last night, Guy came out to our American student bar with us. I convinced him to come with us on our last night. He wasn't happy about it, but he came with us anyway. And then on the right there, that was pretty much every night it was nice out. We had dinner out there. That was Guy's backyard. It was beautiful. He's a gardener, so obviously his yard's been beautiful. His house was in tip-top shape, too. But he put the American flag out there too, you know, we're the liberators and all. But he was a funny guy. He was super nice, very hospitable, and yeah, it was awesome staying with him. It was awesome. Okay, so this is a short, is a little bit shorter video. It's just a summary of what happened. I didn't actually make this video, but yeah, this is pretty much the end of the presentation. After this video, there's more videos that are just like pictures that just slide through that you can look at, but it's already been long enough. So I also kind of included those because I thought those would be happening while we're eating, but we already ate. So after this video, I can take any questions, and yeah, that'll be it. So this is a summary of the whole trip, this video.
Don't forget to make a wish. 1, 2. This is the best night in Europe so far.
Watch it drinking. Rum my whiskey. Now won't you have a double with me?
So that last video there, we were in Malta, and there was a woman there having her bachelorette party, and they had like a list of things they wanted to do, and she had to get a piggyback ride from a random guy, so I had to do that around the bar. But yeah, are there any questions or anything? So I got there January 23rd. Actually, I flew to Chicago a day early on accident, so I just stayed in Chicago. But so January 23rd through May 12th. Yeah, it was a long time.
When did you study?
When? That's a good question. The classes were very easy, most of them. From what everyone I talked to, the classes were pretty easy. There wasn't a lot of studying, but I had exams. I had grades. I got good grades by my standards, so I was satisfied. I studied during the week mostly. The weekends there was no studying, just traveling. Yeah.
What is your university?
Oh yeah, I go to Miami University of Ohio. So we, Miami of Florida, stole. We were there first, pretty much. They took the name. Well, the city of Miami, Florida, was there first, but we had a university first. It's this whole thing. Anyway, that's where I go. Go ahead. MUDEC, Miami University Dolibois European Center. Dolibois is the name of the ambassador I talked about who founded the center. Yes, a long time ago. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's Miami's program. No one else goes there. It's kind of their European study abroad program. They have other programs in Europe, but pretty much their idea is to try and consolidate it there, and then everyone travels to places in Europe from there. Yeah. Yeah, so the payment was actually very cool, is that the tuition was the same, because I was taking Miami classes, and the room and board was actually less than I would have paid to stay in a dorm on campus, but more than I was paying for my apartment off campus. But still, I mean, yeah, for a freshman or sophomore, you're actually paying less to go study abroad in Europe. You're paying more because if you're traveling at all, you're spending a lot of money. But yeah, so the payment was good. What's that? Yes, I'm going to be a senior this year. My plan originally was to study abroad sophomore year. COVID happened my second semester of freshman year, so I went home and I just kind of derailed everything, but I knew I wanted to study abroad. Actually, for my major, I had to study abroad, so this is it. I'm going to be a senior, yeah. Yeah.
How many countries
did you go to? So 14, yeah. 14, yeah. Yeah, it was awesome. And I knew people that went to more and people that went to way less, so you can kind of do whatever you want over there. Mm-hmm.
Did you meet students from other universities?
Yeah, yeah. I did. I met actually a lot of the people my age that I met were studying at different universities in Europe. The education system is a little bit different over there, what ages you go to college or in high school, and the lines are kind of blurred there. But I did meet a lot of people that went to school, and even schools from America that study abroad programs. I met people there too, so. So out of the main six, I knew David and Maddie, his girlfriend, and that was it. The rest of them kind of knew each other. On the trip to Porto with like 16 people, about 14 of those people were in a business fraternity on my campus. So David and Maddie are in that. So I kind of, and there was a good amount of people abroad in that. So I met a lot of people through that. But I only knew those two people. And by the end of it, you kind of knew everybody. It was actually kind of like a high school atmosphere, sort of. It was very like cliquey and like, you know, gossip and drama, what that sort of thing. But I ended up, by the end of the semester, I liked everybody. So. Oh, yeah. We already have plans to hang out again in the fall because we all go to the same university. So, you know, those of us that, there's only a couple seniors. Most of us were sophomores or juniors. So we're all going to be back in the university in Ohio. So we all even said we all want to get together at least one more time, all of us. And then obviously that smaller group I'm going to hang out with a lot because we definitely bonded a lot. So.
Thank you for hearing
that. Yeah. Yes. Thank you guys for asking me. Honestly, it was, like I said, it was awesome to talk about it, and I'm glad you guys gave me this opportunity, and thank you to my technical advisors for making all this possible, because me and my dad have no idea how to do any of this, so thank you. Thank you. Oh, wait a minute, I already won the prize, I don't need it.
Okay, we thank him so much for coming for all this, and Nancy has a little thing.
We're sorry, it's not a beer stein.
That's good. That's good. Thank you so much. Thank you guys again. Thank you. Yes.
Merci.
Oh, yes. Merci. Yeah, merci beaucoup. Gracias. All of it. Danke. I've got it, yeah. Wow. Right. So, I will be getting my bachelor's degree in philosophy and global politics and diplomacy. I'm planning on going to law school, and I kind of want to do immigration law, so there's stuff there. But I also learned on this trip that I like international law, that sort of thing, too. So the options are open. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you again, guys. And the salads were great, by the way. All of them. I tried all of them. I did. Oh, yeah, okay, I'll open it. Here.
Miami Water Bottle, and you guys asked me what university I went to. You knew all along. This is cool. This is a great substitute. Thank you, guys. This is good, because, again, water's not free in Europe, so that's good. Thank you. Thank you again.
Thank you, everybody.
Yes.
Yeah.
Should I open the cards, too? Aw, thank you guys. It means a lot. That was a nice card. Thanks again.